Hello and welcome to Anxiety Diaries, a weekly podcast about mental health, incredible people, and so much more. I'm your host, Scott Neumeyer, and this is episode number 13. If you like what you hear, please make sure you subscribe. And if you get a chance, please head over to Apple Podcasts and rate and review our show. It really does help. Today's episode is one that I've had in the works for quite a while now. I have quoted this person's book on the show numerous times. I have referenced her several times on the show. I'm a huge fan, and a few weeks ago, I basically put together a Twitter campaign to try to figure out how to get her on the show. I wasn't having any luck through the normal routes, so thankfully, she actually found that tweet, contacted her publicist, and it just so happens that her book had just come out here in the US. So her publicist emailed me and asked if I'd want to have her on the show. And of course, I said yes right away. So it's very exciting for me. Today, we're going to talk about anxiety. We're going to talk about ways to deal with anxiety and some unexpected ways that your body can make you more anxious. It's a really great episode, and I hope you'll stick around, listen to the whole thing, and tell your friends. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Today on the podcast, we have Sarah Wilson. She's a journalist, entrepreneur, and the New York Times best-selling author of I Quit Sugar. She's the former editor of Australian Cosmopolitan, and she blogs on philosophy, anxiety, minimalism, toxin-free living, and anti-consumerism at sarahwilson.com. She was ranked in Greatest.com's 100 Most Influential Health Experts in 2015, and as one of the top 200 most influential authors in the world in 2017 and 2018. She lives in Sydney, Australia, rides a bike everywhere, is a compulsive hiker, and is eternally curious. Her new book, First We Make the Beast Beautiful, A New Journey Through Anxiety, recently hit shelves in the United States, and you could find it anywhere books are sold. It's a fantastic book. She's got a lot of incredible things to say. And without further ado, here is Sarah Wilson. Welcome to the podcast, Sarah Wilson. How are you today?
I'm really good. Yeah, very glad to be finally talking with you.
Yeah, after all this time, I've read this book actually quite a while back. I believe it must have come out on Kindle ahead of the US release.
Yes, it did.
So this title and this book cover are just so beautiful to me. I'm curious, I know that this quote is from a Chinese proverb and you'd found it from another book, but did you know all along that this was the title that you were going to use for this book?
Yeah, I absolutely did. The book's been percolating in my brain for 7-8 years, and I'd been researching and sort of going down the rabbit hole, which, as you know, Scott, it's one of the great things about being anxious, is that when you get something on your mind, you have to just take it to the nth degree. And the title had been something that jumped out probably 2 years before I published the book. But also the design, I also knew, like, I was traveling the world interviewing people. At the same time, I was going to bookstores and feeling books and looking at covers and really wanting to make sure that the whole package was something that came together all at the same time and wasn't done in different stages. So I wanted it to have a very personal moleskin diary feel for people. So it's kind of, but also a gift, like sort of almost special enough to give as a gift to somebody who, a loved one who has anxiety. So yeah, thank you for noticing.
Sure, yeah. And I do feel like the title itself is extremely fitting for kind of what you do and how you feel about anxiety. You know, you prescribe to this notion of kind of using the anxiety rather than, you know, being afraid of the anxiety. Can you tell the listeners who may not quite be as familiar with you or the book a little bit about yourself and about what the book's about?
Yeah, I'm an Australian. You can tell that by my accent, I'm sure. A journalist for over 20 years. I was the editor-in-chief of Cosmopolitan, and I hosted various commercial TV shows, sort of cooking and so on. I then got quite unwell with an autoimmune disease called Hashimoto's. It's a disease of the thyroid, and I got very, very sick. I wasn't able to walk or work for almost a year. And I lost everything. So I went and lived in an army shed in the forest and sort of based myself there for a year and a half to try and get better. And in that process, I was writing a column for a newspaper or a magazine inside the Sunday paper. where I would experiment with different ways to get well, which I figured was extremely smart because it killed two birds with one stone. You know, I was getting treatments while writing about it and earning a very modest income. One of the experiments I did was to quit sugar. And so weirdly enough, it just took off. I posted it on my blog. Twitter had just been invented. So I started to tweet about this stuff and share some of my recipe ideas, and more people wanted to know about it. And before I knew it, it developed into an Amazon bestseller selling ebook. It became a New York Times bestseller when I put out the print book. It's, you know, in 113 countries. And I developed an online program as well, which has seen about 1.5 million people around the world quit sugar. So that's what I've been doing for the last sort of 7 or 8 years. But throughout all of this, I was also really wanting to investigate my anxiety in the same way. So I guess, look, I'm not a doctor, I'm not an expert. However, I have journalistic skills that took me, you know, sort of around the world, interviewing His Holiness the Dalai Lama, Oprah's life coach, all kinds of different people in the anxious space, I suppose, and spiritual space to get my answer.
There's a moment in the book where I actually had to put it down because it was hitting a little bit too close to home for me. And then I had to pick it back up.
Really?
Yeah. It's just the way you describe some of the things that you go through is incredible. And this is kind of quite a new perspective in anxiety. You know, there was always this idea that people wanted to beat anxiety or fight it instead of figuring out how to get rid of it. You're actively saying kind of, screw it, this is a part of me and I'm going to make it beautiful and useful.
Yeah.
How long did it take you to kind of come to that?
Oh, many, many, many years. And of course, I still kind of have to work to remind myself of it. And I still have these episodes, I suppose you'd call them, where it all becomes too big for me. And, you know, I was recently in New York to do some publicity for the book, and I hadn't slept for 6 days and I hit rock bottom. And, you know, of course, I forgot most of the stuff I'd written about.
Right.
Eventually, I clawed my way back to remembering it all again. So, yeah, I struggle with it still myself to see it as a beautiful beast. But I suppose, you know, the research that I did and which I share in the book really kind of started to paint a picture I couldn't ignore. Like, we know that the medical model hasn't worked, you know, because it would have worked by now if of any use. And of course, look, there is some use to medication and we do need it at times. And I'm very honest in the book to say that I go on and off it quite regularly when I need it. And I know when I need it now. But I just felt that if you look back through history, if you look at the, you know, sort of pretty much all the major inventions and creative works, there was somebody behind it who had some kind of anxious disorder. It doesn't take much to put two and two together and go, well, maybe that's why we have anxiety. Maybe it is the very grist to the mill of creativity and drawing the human species towards a better place. And if that's the case, then let's stop fighting the tide and trying to silence it. And anyone with anxiety, and I'm sure anyone listening to this, would say, yeah, it's impossible. And I say to young people in particular, I say, do you feel that your anxiety, it's going to lead you somewhere, that it's not something that should be silenced? And people say, yes, I do. And that is part of the problem of the treatment of anxiety, is that we often resist it because it doesn't feel right to silence it. So I just wanted to have a discussion. And really, my book only claims to be a conversation, a new conversation, to get people thinking about it for themselves, because it's a very personal experience. You know, nobody has the same kind of or flavor of anxiety. All that we have in common is, I suppose, the commonality, Scott, I think, is this kind of needing to reach the truth, to know why we're here and what it's all about and how to make life better. You know, I think that's at I think that's what we have in common, and we all express it in different ways. It's a sort of a tone or a type of conversation I don't profess to be to have a final answer on, but I just think that it having the conversation in itself helps, because you can see it lightens the load and it stops that kind of constant battle to eradicate something that can't be eradicated, you know?
Right.
Which is a cause for anxiety in itself.
Yeah, you're always wondering, when's it going to get better? When's it going to get better? But how about we use that instead?
That's right. And it leaves your life on pause, you know? And it leaves you in a state of feeling like a failure,
right,
because you haven't been able to eradicate it.
And it makes you feel like, are you not fighting hard enough? Is that what it is?
Absolutely. Everybody else seems to be coping. What about, you know, everybody, as I say, I think in the first chapter of the book, everyone else got the guidebook to life. Why didn't I? How come I haven't got the secret to kind of having my stuff together, you know?
Yeah. And you mentioned how singular anxiety is, and I totally agree with you, how it's so different for every person. How are some of the ways that your anxiety manifests?
I have been diagnosed on many occasions with bipolar, and I struggle to sort of accept a label, I suppose, but I tend to have incredible manic episodes where I am pretty high. My thoughts are very expansive and fast, and I have this absolute desire from my core to connect with people and to connect kind of, I don't know, sort of logical dots. I want to make things happen, and I want to, what if I did this and I could do that, and nothing goes fast enough for me. And so that can actually make me spiral into a type of anxiety, which is almost like a frenetic mania, which is just, I sometimes feel like I'm running down a hill and I'm moving faster than my legs can spin. It feels very out of control, and I know that a crash is imminent at the bottom. So that's sort of my bipolar experience. And then often a lack of sleep is inherent in that, and I'll get sick. I've got an autoimmune disease, which makes the lack of sleep factor very hard to handle. And then I've got obsessive compulsive disorder, which I've had from a very young age, and it manifests in around nighttime. So I have this fear that if I don't get enough sleep and I wake up in the morning, I won't be able to, obsessive compulsive behavior always has this part of it. It's to do with safety and hygiene of your loved ones. So my sense is that the people around me won't be safe. My family won't be safe. That's sort of the kind of circular logic that plays out. And in terms of how it plays out in my life, I've got a bunch of routines I've got to go through at nighttime to be able to go to bed and to be able to sleep. And some of them border on the ridiculous. Right. My friends do like to laugh, and various partners in my life have found it kind of, well, not particularly attractive. I've got to wear earplugs, and quite often I wear two sets of earplugs. I wear the sort of the swimming kind of silicon over the top of another set of, you know, sort of supersonic highest DPI earplugs. I have to wash and make sure I'm clean. There's a whole bunch of quite personal kind of habits that I just must do. And the difference between sort of obsessive compulsive disorder and maybe having an obsession or a compulsion is that if I don't do things, these particular compulsions, my obsession will not abate. So some people might listen to this and go, oh, I have to do that, or I do that. But what would happen if somebody actually held you back from being able to do it? And I can't fathom that. You know, if I'm camping, I will still have to carry in water, or I'll bathe in a stream with ice floating in it. I will go that to that extreme to go through my rituals. And then I have what I call anxiety spirals, which are quite different to panic attacks. I go into detail in the book to explain the difference. But yeah, my anxiety spirals are essentially when my thoughts go too fast and they compound and they kind of knot into this gnarly ball of wool. And I'm trying to release the ball of wool, but it just gets tighter and tighter, and the thoughts just go and go and go. And until I kind of reach a cul-de-sac, I mentioned before, when I hit the bottom, you know, it's kind of, I reach this cul-de-sac where there's nowhere else to go. I've tried everything. I've tried, what if I do this and I do this and I do that? And nothing seems to be a solution. And I just feel like there is nowhere left to go. And at those points, I can get quite worryingly nihilistic. And I have to reach out. I've trained myself to reach out to someone at those points. But on the flip side, the other way it plays out, which, you know, is what we want to find in all of this, the positive way that it plays out is I care about everything. And now that I've written the book about it, I actually am able to own that. So I accept I'm in the middle of writing another book at the moment, and I am a rare author who's there at every day of the shoot. I design my fonts. I think for 3 days about the font size, and the upshot of that is people like you notice it, you know, and that to me is just wonderful. Like, if you're going to do something in this lifetime, do it properly, you know. So I know I care, and I know that anything that I put my mind to will probably turn out pretty well as a result. Even though I doubt myself the whole way, I kind of have learnt that because I do care so much, at least I know every stone was unturned, you know, to ensure that I tried to get the best possible outcome. The other flip side, you know, the positive side of all of it is I actually am genuinely interested in so many things. I'm 44, and I look around, and a lot of people around me, I think, are inherently bored, yeah, you know.
Sure.
And I you know, sort of my various anxious quirks see me do a few weird things. I've lived out of a sort of a 30-pound backpack for sometimes 6 months at a time. I've lived out of one suitcase for 8 years, and it's allowed me a lot of freedom and incredible experiences. And I also do some risky stuff, I suppose. I know that I need to kind of play out my mania at times through physical risks. So, you know, I was a downhill mountain bike racer. I used to do 24-hour mountain bike races. I've ridden for 5 weeks at a time on my own across different parts of the world. I ocean swim where there's the threat of sharks, you know. Right.
You live in Australia where there are spiders the size of small cats.
Yes. I grew up in the country, so I'm sort of quite used to all of that. But, yeah, I hitchhike, you know. And they're all calculated risks in some ways, but, you know, I'm a grown woman. I'll go and climb a tree. It's I do these things, and they actually bring me incredible joy. And I actually have a life where I have quite a free life, I suppose, because my anxiety sees me having to do these things just to kind of keep interested and stimulated. And as a result, my life probably has a fair bit of color to it.
It's pretty incredible how anxiety can create almost this hypervigilance in people to be able to focus on things mm-hmm. so well. And, you know, for me, I feel the same way. I'm 38 years old. I've got two kids. And most people I know that are my age are happy just going to work, coming home and doing the same thing. But, you know, for me, I have to learn something new all the time. And that was what this podcast came out of, you know? So I totally feel exactly what
don't you think it's a fear of going to work, coming home, sitting on the couch, watching TV, that probably made us get anxious. And maybe it was the anxiety, you know, there was this kind of, there's got to be something more to life, you know. And then maybe it was the anxiety was the right stimulation in our brain that got us off the couch, you know. And I say this in my book, you know, it was probably a bipolar or some kind of anxious dude that kind of left the pack many, many years ago, went over the hill and went, oh, guys, there's these people that have invented a wheel. We should get onto it, you know.
We should figure that out. Do something about that.
That's right. Let's do it. It's always been kind of the odd person in the pack that's kind of done that. And I think, you know, that's also the impetus that gets us off the couch to go and do something a little bit different.
Yeah. Now, you talk about in the book a lot of different things that kind of you use to manage your anxiety, or, you know, you have, you know, breathing rituals and things like that, which I've talked about on the podcast before as well. But the two things that I really want to ask you about, one of my favorite things you talk about is the gratitude rituals. Can you explain a little bit about how gratitude, empathy, looking out for others, et cetera, work in dealing with anxiety as well?
Yeah, I can. It's interesting. I actually learned about it all by interviewing John Dermottini, who I think has trademarked the gratitude effect. He owns those words, apparently. He's very, very, very full on about that sort of gratitude effect, obviously. But I sort of looked into the science behind it after I interviewed him, just to kind of go, well, you know, what's the deal here? And in fact, quite a bit of, you know, science has been, research has been conducted into why and how it works. And essentially, it's kind of funny. The anxious part of our brain, the flight or fight mechanism, is one of the oldest parts of our brain. It evolved when we kind of, I don't know, crawled onto Earth, you know, as tadpoles, you know, and it's been necessary for our survival. But the upshot of that is that it's a very, very primitive, basic part of our brain. And it's essentially a monotasker. It can only do one thing at once. And so scientists over the years have found that there's actually ways to trick anxiety into kind of silence. And one of those is reflecting in gratitude on what we've kind of either experienced or achieved during a day. And the actual process of looking at our life, looking back over our life, you know, even if it's just in bed at the end of the day, you look back on what happened during that day and name three things that you're grateful for. It creates this congruency between what you hope for and what actually happened. And that sort of process in our brain shuts down the anxious mechanism. I mean, it sounds ridiculous, but that's why it can actually be a great technique for getting to sleep, and that's what I use it for. It puts me into a nice space where my day has some closure. I experience that congruency and my anxiety does significantly sort of back off so that I can get to sleep. And one of the other exercises that I mention a lot in the book, as you'd know, Scott, is walking. Walking is also another thing that we can do that shuts down the anxious part of the brain because it just can't function while we're walking. And I think anybody who knows the benefits of just getting out of the house and going for a 20-minute walk when you're having an anxiety attack, that they'll know that it actually does work. So I just found that really interesting. Obviously, you did too.
Yeah. For sure. Mm. It's interesting. A boss of mine once told me his children were having anxiety, and before they went to bed, they would do something called five good things, where they would just name five random things that exist in the universe that are good, or there are parts of them that are good. And it sounds like it right in line with what you're talking about. I tried it with my daughter, and it helped her too. So it's pretty incredible.
Yeah, it's a great one. I mean, in the olden days, we called it prayer, didn't we?
Yeah, I guess so. Sure.
You know, and there's a lot of people who still do pray, and I think the benefits of prayer are essentially the same. You know.
Yep. So the other thing I wanted to ask you about, and this is the one that I need to know more about because it's something that I think I need to focus more on. You probably know where I'm going with this, is gut health. Diet and you know, your I Quit Sugar book. How does gut health actually feed into anxiety?
Oh, massively. And it's quite recent. In fact, even in the writing of my book, more and more research, you know, sort of emerged. And since I wrote I Quit Sugar, and it's kind of funny that the two, you know, they're the two books I've ended up writing. And as I've published the second one, the science brings both kind of subjects together. So previously, up until probably about four or five years ago, we really accepted that mental health issues were about a sort of chemical imbalance in the brain. So all the medication addressed that. We now know that science is pretty faulty and really doesn't stack up. Instead, what they're finding as a far more convincing explanation at a biological level is that it stems from the gut. And, you know, you probably know this, 80% of the serotonin in our body is in our stomachs, not in our brain. And, you know, anyone who's been on medication for anxiety knows that it's all about trying to up the amount of serotonin because that helps convey messages so you don't have repeated messages and which, of course, leads to anxiety. So gut health, I guess there's several parts to this sort of puzzle. It's a lot to do with bacteria, having decent bacteria in our gut, and that plays up the neural pathways into the brain, but also inflammation. Inflammation is essentially, you know, there's a phrase, I think I have it in the book, inflammation in the gut means inflammation in the brain.
Yeah, you actually say, put simply, if you have fire in the gut, you have fire in the brain.
Thank you. I said it better in the book.
we all do, right? So, all our writers.
Yeah,
do.
That's right. When we have the time to come out with these things. But that is basically where the science is at right now. The most conclusive science as to why, and some of us get anxious and some of us don't, they say it comes from the gut. And again, you know, what comes first, chicken or the egg? I don't know. In some ways, it doesn't really matter if we know that the way to modulate both any kind of inflammatory diseases like autoimmune disease or any kind of gut issues, if we know that the treatment for that is the same as the treatment for anxiety, it's like, you know, bam, two birds with one stone. And that's certainly how I manage my health. A lot of people with anxiety also have an inflammatory disease, also have a lot of problems with their gut, and all of it is the same thing. So on the one hand, I think anxiety is obviously a biological issue, you know, but it's also a spiritual issue and an emotional issue. And it can be a beautiful thing. We can manage it, modulate it, steer it to be a wonderful thing in our life, which, you know, at times flares up and causes us issues, if we can keep it at a level that's not going to get out of control. And so managing things via gut is a really great way to do that. Sugar, of course, is now known as probably the biggest trigger of both gut dysbiosis, which is the bacteria being all out of whack, but also inflammation in our body. It's probably absolutely no coincidence that when I cut out sugar, you know, my health, both mental and physical, improved, and a lot of other people around the world found the same thing. So, yeah.
Yeah, I'm working on it.
I can't recommend enough cutting out the sugar. I'll tell this to you and your listeners, like, be kind to yourself, because if you do have an inflammatory disease or a mental health issue, you will find it more difficult to cut out sugar because you are probably more addicted,
right?
Because the whole setup of your body is such that it clutches at sugar for energy in a far more gnarly way yeah, in a far more gnarly way than the everyday person. So give yourself permission to be a bit of a failure at quitting sugar, but at the same time, keep trying, you know, yeah. But accept it will be harder than it is for the average person.
Yeah, that's what I was actually going to ask you, because, you know, for me, when I'm with someone with OCD tendencies and anxiety, you know, you want to do these things that will help, quitting sugar or exercising. But sometimes when you start to quit sugar or when you start to exercise, those feelings that you get are very similar to what happens when you're anxious. So it's very difficult for someone like us.
You're absolutely right. Yeah. And I mentioned that in the book. It is, you're absolutely correct that it can trigger the very same flight or fight response. But if you are smart about it, and if you can be very conscious of the fact this is going to be hard and I'll probably get this reaction, but at least I know what it is and we're just going to muddle our way through it, that is a comfort. And comfort sometimes all you need, right? You know? I mean, that's why I wrote the book. I wrote the book to not say, you can get rid of anxiety. It's to say, you know what? You're not alone. And essentially, that's why I wrote the book from my own selfish point of view, is I wanted to know I wasn't alone. My book is almost like a sort of reaching out to the rest of humanity to go, hey, have I got this right? Are we, you know, like, you know, are we good with this? You know, am I on the right track? And am I okay? You know, that was very much part of it.
Yeah, you say actually because one of the reasons you wrote the book, because I'm sick of being lonely.
Yeah.
Do you feel less lonely now that it's out in the world?
I do. I mean, I think it's one of those ironies which I tick off throughout the book that is inescapable when you have a mental health issue, that you are going to have to suffer on this on your own. I think it's Anaïs Nin says it. Anxiety is something that you have to must suffer alone, but at least we can reach out to others and say, I know. And I find a great deal of comfort in that. I am certainly less lonely because I'm having far more interesting conversations, far more nourishing conversations, albeit mostly with strangers, which is sort of one of the ironies I flag in the book, that I find the company of strangers far less stressful than loved ones at times. And I've accepted that that's just the way it is. You know, that's just part of my experience in this lifetime. And it's been pretty wonderful. You know, I get to have conversations like this now, you know, rather than, I don't know, weather or...
I can tell you, I've written a lot of things. I've published a lot of things, and I've never gotten as many responses as I have for things I wrote about, you know, my personal anxiety or this podcast. It's incredible how many people are out there that are just looking for somebody to talk to.
Oh, absolutely. And I think, and to read, you know, we want to read more nourishing stuff, and we want to read stuff that actually has, you know, a spiritual, what matters in life kind of element to it. And I think politically where we're at the moment, you know, in the Western world, we need it more than ever, you know.
Aside from when you're feeling anxious and you're in the midst of those, you know, anxiety spirals, what are some of the things that you do on a daily basis to take care of yourself and kind of ward off those bad feelings?
I get out into nature and sun as much as I can. And, you know, that just is a practice. And, you know, I'm lucky I live where I do because there's, a hell of a lot of sun. If I can walk to a meeting, I will, as opposed to catching a bus or driving. I just make sure I get fresh air. I'm out in life as often as possible. And that certainly helps ward off, you know, anxiety. I read a lot. I didn't read growing up. I grew up in the country in a big family where if you were seen reading, it meant that you were available for chores. So that's why I became such an outdoors person. It was like, you know, get away from the load of nappies you had to hang on the line. But I read now, and it's a joy. And I've got to say, I read old school books as opposed to digital. And it's, again, that notion of going at the same pace as this discerning mind. Walking does that. Handwriting does that. So does reading. It slows our thoughts down. We're not toggling between screens. And that actually emulates the anxious experience. And I believe it's why a lot of teenagers today are experiencing increased anxiety, not so much that their lives are more stressful, but they're emulating the anxious experience by kind of running madly in this kind of flight or fight kind of simulated sort of scenario between, you know, soccer practice, this, that, computer games, 20,000 screens open, you know.
Yeah.
So I do that. I do try to shut down. I try to practice a bit of self-respect as well in and around shutting down technology sort of by 9 o'clock at the latest. I give myself brownie points if it's 8 o'clock at night. I try to do things where I leave my phone behind and things like that. That makes a big difference. I know.
You're very brave.
I mean, I know anyone listening. Yes, I know. Isn't it ridiculous that we are at that stage where that is an achievement, but it's true. So I do that. I eat good food. That's something that I know is a really good practice. Yeah, and look, getting into nature, as I say, even on weekends. If I've had a stressful week, I'll just go and get on a train, go to some bushland and do a sort of a 3 or 4 hour hike. And just being in dirt, being amongst trees, discovering, you know, almost playing, that's my happiness.
It shows. I mean, following your Instagram account is extremely inspiring because almost all of the pictures are on some type of beach somewhere and they're all beautiful.
Yeah. It's some people say, why are you on social media? I'm like, well, I just want to inspire people to get out of shopping malls and do different things, you know?
It is quite beautiful to see. Where can the listeners find you online?
I have a blog, sarahwilson.com, that's been going for many years. Instagram, if you just look up Sarah Wilson, ditto Facebook, it'll probably be fairly high up there. Yeah, please do follow me on Instagram. It's not a bad place, especially for the anxious, because you can just scroll through and get inspiration for some hikes.
Well, thank you very, very much. This has been an honor. Your book is fantastic. I think everybody should read it. And I've seen more pictures of your book on people's nightstands on Instagram than almost any other book. It is a beautiful book, and it's an incredible book. So thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for your time.
Call us, leave us a message at 732-903-4441 or drop us an email at anxietydiariespodcast@gmail.com. You can find the podcast at www.anxietydiariespodcast.com, where you can sign up for our newsletter as well. And you can find us on Instagram and Facebook at Anxiety Diaries Podcast. We're also on Twitter at Anxiety Diary Pod. Thanks again for listening. Be well, and we'll see you next week.